Hello and welcome to the World Beyond Belief. I'm again Paul Marco. And as you can see from my attire, it's a little chilly here in the Hacienda Beyond Belief, but we're warm and we're going this year. We've had several interactions on gang stalking already this year. And I think between the wonderful PhD experts that we have that just happen to be target individuals, we're getting a handle on how to move forward on this thing. Stay tuned for that. We're coming up with many videos on that. And today, again to blow our minds, we have Dr. Eric Karlstrom to tell us what he's found out. He's deep research into the subject, probably one of the most leading researchers, if not the prime researcher on the subject. He's going to tell us what he's uncovered, and we're going to talk about going forward with this. So this is an exciting time, and this is going to be an extremely exciting interview, and I know I'm not overselling it because it always blows me away when he's here. So welcome to the World Beyond Belief, Dr. Karlstrom. It's an honor to have you here from an undisclosed location.
Well, thank you, Dr. Mark. Thank you, Dr. Paul Marco. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
You're cutting in and out, but let's try to do it. And if we have any trouble, we'll reconnect until we get it going.
Okay. Well, we have had a series of interviews on gang stalking. This is kind of the popular term. I think we can increase our understanding of this phenomena by researching. I would like to report what I've learned from a series of books that I've been reading that are now kind of all marked up. This is a great book by Mark M. Rich called New World War, Revolutionary Methods for Political Control, in which he's got another one as well called The Hidden Agenda or The Hidden Evil. But this he exposes the enormous paper trail that underlies this phenomenon that we call gang stalking, including, you know, the laws and executive orders,
Eric,
that permit the military.
Yes? Eric, you need to repeat the name of the book and the author because you kind of cut out during that thing.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
The book is The New World War, Revolutionary Methods for Political Control. The author is Mark M. Rich. And it came out, I think, in 2011. And he documents the military papers that pertain to what's going on now and the laws that have been passed and executive orders that allow the intelligence and military complex to target civilians. And of course, there's a lot of legalese terms in there, but I would like to go through some of these terms with you today.
Good.
To show you and the audience how enormous this system of political and psychological control is. It is global, it is interagency, and this is, as we've established in the past, it's the modern extension of the FBI's COINTELPRO counterintelligence program of the 60s and 70s, where they neutralized political dissidents and groups of dissidents using a lot of these very same techniques. This is now married with the information and results that are coming out of the CIA's MK Ultra mind control programs. And then what I'd like to talk about tonight or today is another component of this is this is the modern extension of the Phoenix program, which was a CIA program in Vietnam in which they targeted the civilian quote unquote support system for the Viet Cong. And what it wound up to be was a bounty hunting program where they would create lists and then they would go in and neutralize, i.e. kill by many, many techniques, the civilian quote unquote infrastructure of Vietnam. This is a way to terrorize the population. And we have now another excellent book that I would like to talk about. This fellow, Douglas Valentine has written a book about the Phoenix program, which I haven't read yet, but I'm going to get. This one is can't come out this year. The CIA has organized crime, how illegal operations corrupt America and the world. And Douglas Valentine's about our age, and he's seen it all, and he's kept going as a researcher and written about how, you know, this underbelly of corruption has affected America and the world. He has a couple great chapters on the Phoenix program and how that has morphed now into the Department of Homeland Security. And this is a conclusion also that has come, that is included in this book by Marshall Thomas, Monarch, the New Phoenix Program. Now, this is a slightly older book, 2007, but he's come to the same conclusions. And if you put these three together with, again, the secret team, the CIA and its allies in control of the United States and the world by L. Fletcher Prouty, who was very high in Army intelligence and, in fact, was the liaison between the Army and the CIA for a 7 or 8 year period under Eisenhower's administration, with Alan Dulles as CIA director. You put this stuff together, and it becomes much more clear what we're dealing with here. And of course, we have to remember that most people who are targeted individuals around the world in this program are unaware, and this is by design. It's intended that they not be aware that they're being targeted. They're being neutralized, they're being destabilized, they're being destroyed by a combination of things, including non-lethal weapons, which includes what they call PSYOP, psychological operations, and we'll talk a little bit more about that because this is a vast field in the military. And non-lethal weapons, of course, also include directed energy weapons, the so-called soft kill, silent kill, slow kill, but they actually do kill. They can be ramped up to kill. And this includes microwaves, millimeter waves, acoustic waves, and lasers, basically. And then, of course, the technology just goes on because the Pentagon has been doing this, you know, over several decades with enormous budgets. And a lot of this is black budget. Yeah. A lot of it isn't black budget. But again, it's very high, very high tech. We can assume the Pentagon is at least 50 to 100 years ahead yes. of the general population in terms of their technology. So even going through books like this, I don't consider myself to be an expert. I'm just approaching the true scope of these enormous programs. It would be wonderful if you could get a military person to come on your show and talk about it from a military perspective, because this is what these guys are paid to do and have been paid to do. We have lots and lots of experts. Get John B. Alexander or Michael Aquino or many of the people who have been involved with these programs, because they really are the experts on it. And if I could start, Paul, with just giving some of the conclusions of these authors, then launch into it, and I can get into more detail. This is coming from Marshall Thomas, who wrote Monarch, the New Phoenix Program. He has a 15-minute YouTube, which you can look at, in which he summarizes the program. I think he did an excellent job, so I'll just kind of state what he states. And I want to start broad, because ultimately this is a war between the haves and the have-nots. It's a war between the super, super rich, the 0.01% and less, and the rest of us. That's what it is. And he makes the point, and so does Douglas Valentine, and so does Mark M. Rich. Here's what Marshall Thomas says. He says, unwitting Americans and the citizens of other nations are facing a destabilization operation, one designed to bring down the existing world governments, it's all 195 or whatever, existing world governments, and to institute a one world government fascist dictatorship in its place. So now we have the context. as we'll see as we get into this, what you're doing is you're pitting large segments of the population, including military, intelligence, civilian spies, against dissenters and others who have been designated as targets. And so you have to decide that society cannot last long. So even to be careful how we expose this, because the double bind here is that if we attack and destroy the system, we attack and destroy the entire nation. And that is what the powers that be want. So what we need to do is go back to the Constitution and arrest and prosecute the guilty, mm-hmm. which, as we'll find, is an enormous number of people. Remember, we did an excellent, I thought, well, I shouldn't say excellent, but we did a very detailed program on 911 and the 46 drills that were yes. ongoing on the day of 9/11 that were discovered by Webster Tarpley, the economic historian, PhD. And what we found out there was there was an enormous number of agencies involved. There's NATO, there's UN, there's the Air Force dominantly, there's the New York Police Department, on and on and on. Well, I think there's a principle there. The principle is if you spread out the guilt so that the guilty outnumber right. everybody else, how are you going to prosecute them? And that, I think, is where we're at. Now, that said, not all people in those agencies would be in the know as to what the real implications of what they're doing are, for instance, in these drills that, you know, remove the warfighter right. planes, the fighter jets out of the D.C. area, et cetera. They're following orders. So we have to, you know, derail that system. But anyway, let me continue with Thomas's comment here. The U.S. intelligence agencies, in conjunction with DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, Stanford Research Institute, Los Alamos National Laboratory, and companies like Raytheon and Lockheed have set up a counterinsurgency war. That's what they've always been, what the CIA does every time. What they do is they go attack individuals in another country or the country. And then when people try to defend themselves, the CIA and the military label them as insurgents. Okay, now the CIA and the military are the counterinsurgency. So they're going to go after those insurgents. Well, they created the whole conflict in the first place, right. and the insurgents are just the ones who are trying to stay alive. So they've set up a counterinsurgency. There's nothing that has changed. Now it is being applied worldwide. Have set up a counterinsurgency war that is taking place on a worldwide basis, aimed at potential enemies such as political activists and whistleblowers. These targets are generally people with a high, very high IQ who are also capable of influencing the people around them, as well as having a history of political activism. Then he says, this counterinsurgency war that is being waged against these individuals is portrayed as a type of game, a stalking game, the most dangerous game. You know, what's the reality TV show, The Hunger Games, you know, perhaps called Watch Him Run, sometimes such game that is taking place on the internet so people can observe the targets using DARPA tracking technology, GPS technology, and RFID technology that follows the target everywhere they go, in their home, their car, their place of work, or even in cross-continental travel, anywhere on the surface of the earth. So I'm in Baja, California, and I'm sure I haven't gotten away from, you know, being monitored and surveilled. There is no way that the targets can escape this game, the stalking game. And then he goes on and he talks about how this is really a combination of psychological operations, which we call gang stalking, and directed energy weapons, which we call psychotronic or electronic warfare weapons. Combine them, it's all non-lethal weapons, NLW. And we have documents, you know, from the CFR in 1995 saying we're going to have to use these on enemies of the state, basically, internal enemies who, you know, aren't getting with the program. And we're going to do it secretly and we're going to do it in combination. And so that's in there's so many documents. We're going to use these weapons in combination. We're going to use them secretly. And this is in, you know, scads of military documents. Yeah. Scads of military, and I'll give you some examples. But before I do that, let me just give you the conclusions of Marshall Thomas. And I think what we'll see is that in our previous discussions, we've gotten part but all of the program. He's saying that the modern gang stalking program is coming out of, again, COINTELPRO. It's coming, FBI's COINTELPRO, CIA's MKUltra. Also, the fact that the U.S. government has experimented non-consensually on over 500,000 people during the last 40, 50 years, you know, in all kinds of experiments, radiation, you know, et cetera, chemical, biological weapons. And also the Phoenix program. And the Phoenix program is very important to understand the Phoenix program. So we'll talk a little bit about that. Then he says all three illegal programs have been enfolded into a single program using the military strategy known as force multiplication to accomplish three aims in one single terrible program of, one, torture to modify behavior. So this is torture. They know it's torture. They want it to be torture. They know how to torture. This is what they learned with the MKUltra. Two, experimentation to perfect the new weapons. Okay, we got that part in previous interviews. This is a weapon system that they're refining because they want to apply it more widely. And then three, neutralization of people on a hit list. Okay, so that's Thomas's synopsis. And he said this is back in 2007 when he wrote this, and we know more now. But he said the case that this is occurring is based on four facts. And these are the bare bones case to avoid confusion, disinformation, and circular arguments that lead nowhere. And he says, number one, MKUltra, the CIA's mind control experiments, took place at over 80 institutions, including 44 universities, 15 private companies, 12 hospitals, and 3 prisons. The current illegal program that he's calling Monarch, which we're calling gang stalking, which the real name is unknown, but we'll get to it in a minute. Yeah. It's equally complex. The four facts are all that is necessary to convince a reasonable person that this atrocity is really taking place and demands immediate action. Next one, he's saying the microwave weapons, directed energy weapons, like the denial system, ADS, and millimeter radars are public electromagnetic weapons. You can buy one. You get yourself the right magazine, you can buy one, you know, and then maybe we just have a war between our neighbors, you know. It's like, right, I'll get my little computer device that zaps you, and you get your little computer device that zaps me. Okay, the Russians used microwave weapons to attack the American embassy in Moscow in the 1950s. In response, the U.S. began a secret crash program to develop microwave weapons. The next one, number three, there's a criminal history dating back to 1943, a prior pattern of criminal behavior all through the Cold War. Again, 500,000 U.S. citizens were used as human guinea pigs in nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons development programs. And again, the FBI COINTEL program government had hit lists of political activists, and they executed them. If you were to tally up the battle between the FBI and the Black Panthers, the FBI killed 28 Black Panthers. The Black Panthers didn't kill anybody in the FBI. So it's 28-0 in favor of the FBI. Right. And, of course, the FBI and the CIA were setting up these other cults, like the Seminis Liberation Army with Patty Hearst, and also the Manson cults. I mean, these are ways to get into the society and play around with these techniques and technologies and to use these cults for mind control experiments, which they did, of course, yeah, especially after they were forced underground by the Church Committee hearings in 1975, which exposed over 10,000 illegal CIA operations between 1947 and 1975. Well, of course, now you've got that amount of time, or a little bit probably more since then. Now, how many illegal CIA operations have there been since 1975? I would guess at least that many. And then the last one, credible witnesses, people who have testified that they are targets of classified non-lethal microwave weapons assaults and organized gang stalking. Tom has interviewed more than 200 targets in person and documented their story. He found, unlike others, by the way, that most TIs are political activists or whistleblowers that are around 40 years old, have an above average IQ, and share other commonalities. About 70% are women, apparently. The majority of targets fit a common profile similar to the victims of previous programs. And then he says, persons of interest, military intelligence officers, INSCOM, have worked since 1980 to develop non-lethal weapons for the Army. They publicly advocated using them on civilians to neuter people or neutralize people, the MK Ultra crimes of the CIA, and gave classified weapons to local law enforcement and others. So now these weapons are in the hands of law enforcement and even civilian agencies. And the DHS, of course, is operating, the Department of Homeland Security is operating these fusion centers, 28 of them in all states and major cities. And borderline and superstitions as part of a smokescreen cover-up. In other words, the CIA instigates and infiltrates cults. Military intelligence officers in charge of non-lethal weapons development and government physicists who invent non-lethal technologies for the Army are both loudly advocating borderline beliefs and superstitions like doomsday cults and remote viewing. So we've really entered, really gone over to the dark side. Our intelligence and military definitely has gone over to the dark side. So this needs to be pointed out, corrected. Thomas talks about the five reforms that he sees as a way to end this secret, dirty war. One, open all records and secret archives. Two, disarm all electromagnetic weapons. Three, have a Truth and Reconciliation Committee, TRC. Four, convene an international conference to ban all electromagnetic weapons. By the way, Dennis Kucinich tried to pass a bill in Congress in 2003 that would have done this, but it was voted down. Finally, an international bill of rights that is enforceable such that the state cannot crush its internal enemies. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about the states crushing internal dissent and internal enemies and terrorize the domestic population so that the state is unopposed in all things. If a president imprisons, tortures, or murders their political enemies, then they must be sure that they will end their days in a prison cell. And I added the little parentheses, or by firing squad. I don't think there's enough punishment to mete out to these individuals myself. I think they're beyond the pale, onto the dark side. Now, let me just stop there, Paul, and hear from you. What I'm saying here is that there is an enormous paper trail. The military, Congress, certainly the intelligence agencies have developed this program, taking technology, very secret technology, very high technology, and they have decided to make it global. And so what we're looking at, it's a global police state, much like we had under the Soviet Union, under the Cheka, which was terrorizing the people and did the Red Terror, much like the East German Stasi, in which one out of six citizens were enlisted to become citizen spies and harass and intimidate and surveil their fellow citizens. And this then became the state police or the Stasi. And it was also versions of that in Hungary and Poland and Czechoslovakia and Portugal. So anytime you get a really draconian police state, they want to, you know, put this blanket of terror and deception on the people so that the people are afraid to express themselves. Essentially, of course, this is entirely anti the Constitution. It's antithetical to the U.S. Constitution, which, and the Declaration of Independence, that say that governments are instituted amongst humans so that our God-given rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness are protected. And when governments fail in this basic responsibility, it is our duty and responsibility to alter or abolish those governments. Well, we've gone beyond that point. So now we have a real challenge. I mean, this government has gone off the deep end. And I would just to kind of bring it back to the bigger picture, I would say that, you know, it's an overthrow. We've had an overthrow of our government. We've had several. I think one was in 1913 when the Federal Reserve was established by European bankers, the Rothschilds, and their agents, the Warburgs and the Schiffs, et cetera. Yes. And then when Kennedy was killed, I think this was another overthrow. Our country was taken over by Wall Street and its power and minions. And I think 9/11 has to be seen also as a coup, not so much against the government, which they already controlled, but against the American people, right, which still had a voice. So since 9/11, what we've seen is an attempt to completely submerge and neutralize the American population as a force. Now, what's so fascinating to me is that Donald Trump got in, and he's being inaugurated on this very day, the 20th of January, on a Friday, 2017. He's won on an anti-globalization platform. And yet all of this, you know, this draconian state is to bring in one world government and globalization. So now we have a very schizophrenic situation where Trump is advocating for nationalism. Well, if he really is going to advocate for nationalism, I think he's going to have to stand up for the rights of the American people and the Constitution. So we will see if Trump weighs in on this issue and does something constructive, because theoretically he has the power to call off the dogs of war off of the American people and the people of the world. So America has become the dark empire. We are the beast, if you want to go to the Bible.
Right.
We are the second beast. The first beast probably Israel. And if you and we were the second beast worships the first beast. And if you want to go to that, you know, symbology. But if you want to see what, you know, the American system will look like, look at Israel, because they're you know, the Israeli special forces or whoever, the military, just go right into the area that's owned by the Palestinians. They'll bulldoze the house down. They'll lock up the Palestinians. No due process, no accusations, no, you know, completely totalitarian. So that's kind of where I think we are. And we're in, as the old expression goes, deep doo-doo.
Right. Deep doo-doo. That's a great way to, you know, those are the kind of things you'll get quoted
summarize
on.
Yeah.
You'll get quoted on. No, I think that you're exactly right. And what I think is really interesting about this time, it certainly is the apocalypse, which means the unveiling, the externalization of the hierarchy. If you want to find out who's gang stalking, what they're doing, and about these weapons, you can find it out. That's written in books. Same with geoengineering. You can trace it back to the patents, and the patents are all held by the Rockefellers. If you want to find out about Pizzagate, they've solved Pizzagate. Oh, human beings know who did Pizzagate. They know what's going on there. But, well, we're still conditioned to want to go to the government. We're still conditioned to go back to the triangle. We're still conditioned to go back to the institutions that are rotten. And I think now we know. Now we need a strategy to move forward. And I don't think it's going to be lawsuits. I don't think it's going to. The only glimmer of hope in that, I think, would be Trump. Now, I don't know who Trump works for. But it seems like if there are several factions of globalists, which I think there probably are, I mean, these people are snakes. They compete with one another. If you've ever been in a large organization, you go up above the vice president level, and they're fighting for one cause, but they're out for their own career. And they're psychopaths, so they'll do anything to get there. So what we've got here are competing psychopaths to rule the government. Takeover, the globalist takeover of the world. So that's what we're watching. I think what we're seeing with Trump, and this is my own opinion, I think we're seeing another faction. I think we're seeing the Trump, Putin, Nigel Farage faction against the Soros, Clinton, the old guard that were really pushing for total military state. This is a more charismatic kind of intellectual, if I could say that, type faction that seems to be taking over. Now, how they're going to run the intelligence agencies is going to be the big thing. Or does the intelligence agencies run them? I mean, I think the intelligence agency basically works for the money, the Rothschilds and that whole organization. Now, are the intelligence agencies above the president, or is the president going to have some control over go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, we addressed this when we had our interview about Alan Dulles. Yeah. And Alan Dulles, of course, was the first director of the CIA. Going back to 1953, and he actually bragged that he and his brother, John Foster Dulles, who was Secretary of State, both of whom who had been Wall Street lawyers for Sullivan and Cromwell, the largest Wall Street legal firm, which represented the Rockefellers, et cetera, that he controlled Dwight D. Eisenhower. He bragged that he did, and no doubt he did. And I would argue, and Fletcher Prouty, the author of The Secret Team here, he also argues that it'd be very, very difficult for one individual to stand up to the power of the intelligence agencies. Yeah. William O. Douglas, the Supreme Court Justice, said that very thing after Kennedy was assassinated. It seems like Kennedy might have been an example of somebody who did try to stand up and be the president. And of course, we saw the public execution of President Kennedy. He was mutilated. I mean, they don't know where his brain is.
Yeah.
It's gone. This was obviously an occult style hit, if you get into that aspect of it, but it was also a political hit. And the power structure included the CIA for sure, and, you know, the FBI and many, many other factions, just decided his program was not to their liking, and took him out. So you're right. I mean, the question is, can Trump actually affect the situation now, or are we so completely ruled by intelligence agencies like the CIA? The CIA is above all the others. The NSA can't touch the CIA. The FBI has no jurisdiction over the CIA, and the CIA has absolutely no legal constraints. They do what they want, when they want, where they
sure.
want.
Sure.
So they're above the law, totally. And of course, as you say, they're working for Wall Street and the financial sector. So this has always been the case ever since it was formed. There seems to be enough propaganda to make us think that the CIA is somehow working in our interest. One thing I'd like to really emphasize here, Paul, if I can, is over the years, the CIA and the NSA and the FBI and the alphabet soup agencies, we have 17, I think, intelligence agencies, have used this term, it's national security, ma'am, we can't tell you about this, or we've classified this program because national security. Well, likewise, this issue of national interests, so the State Department is protecting our national interests in Iraq or Chile or whatever. Okay. Well, anybody who knows anything about the State Department for decades would know that the national interest is defined as the corporate interests, the business interests. Likewise, the national security interests have to be understood as protecting the power structure.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with my security or your security. In fact, it's the opposite. It's protecting the security of the system, and which is a corrupt criminal system.
Right.
So the sooner Americans wake up to this basic fact, you know, the sooner we can start to deal with it. That's what I hope we're starting. We're helping that to happen. Let me give you a couple definitions here.
Okay.
This is right out of the book New World War, Revolutionary Methods for Political Control, and this coming out of many, many military documents. It's called 4GW, Fourth Generation Warfare. Okay, this is what they're doing. This is what the gang stalking is. It's a form of political information warfare waged against civilians by a state or other entity. It utilizes civilians and the military, indeed all of society, to target civilian adversaries, also known as domestic state enemies, insurgents, extremists, non-state actors, cells of fanatics, and sometimes even citizen terrorists who value national sovereignty, for instance, or pose some other perceived threat to the state's interests.
Right.
Okay, so here we have this whole system turned upside down, where the power structure is got the guns pointing inward at the individuals who actually believe in the Constitution.
Yes. Yes.
And who believe in national sovereignty, because they want to merge with the world government. And then to go on with that, anyone disseminating information contrary to the state's national security interests may become an enemy.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so here's why I'm an enemy, for instance. I have a website, 911nwo.com. I have one called naturalclimatechange.org. In these sites, I wrote an article in 2002. As a professor of geography at California State University, Stanislaus, I wrote a rather lengthy academic-style article called Reflections on the Origins of 911, Three Scenarios.
Uh-huh.
And in 2002, when there was a lot of fear in the land and people were not sure they wanted to put their name on anything, I put my name on that thing. Well, obviously that seems to have gotten me on a list.
Yeah.
The fact that I challenged the war on terror narrative, that I challenged the 911 narrative, this makes, and of course the global warming nonsense narrative, this makes me a threat to the national security of the state.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is why I've been targeted now with directed energy weapons two or three times at least, and I can talk about that later. And now that I've read more about it, I understand that I was targeted as early as 2006 with directed energy weapons. And let me just continue here. The goal of the new war is the psychological collapse of the new enemies using a combination of tactics. Defeating the new enemies involves the synchronized use of non-lethal directed energy weapons, isolation, deprivation. They're really big on sleep deprivation and social deprivation. They want to isolate you from your support structure. And psyops against individuals and groups. And this is also called the capital T, capital A, which means target audience. You know, it's like the answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer, my friend, is in all these alphabet soup acronyms. It's there in spades. I mean, it's all of the programs that we're experiencing are laid out by the military, by the think tanks, et cetera. The TA is a target audience. Of course, TI, that includes the TIs, the targeted individuals.
Mm-hmm.
A 4GW, fourth generation warfare, is more or less synonymous with, now you've got other position papers and terms, unconventional warfare, UW, and many, many, many articles about that in the military literature. Irregular warfare, capital I, capital R. Asymmetrical warfare, capital A, capital W. Low intensity conflict, capital LIC. Military operations other than war, capital MOOTW. And network centric warfare, capital NCW. This new war involves international interagency cooperation between the military, federal, and local law enforcement, non-governmental organizations, NGOs, intergovernmental organizations, IGOs, the civilian population, including private voluntary organizations, PVOs, and private government contractors. And of course, InfraGuard of the FBI, et cetera. There's many, many of these. This multinational force, MNF, involves NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and the UN, of course, the United Nations, and is termed Civilian Military Operations, CMO. Now, I have to interject here that Doug Valentine in the CIA as organized crime mentions that since 9/11, and I haven't checked his numbers, but he says since 9/11, $8 trillion of taxpayer money has been taken out of social programs and put into the new national security establishment, which is kind of organized by Department of Homeland Security, as we'll get into. Okay, so then go on with this 4GW. In its unconventional warfare manual, the U.S. Army states that these new enemies will be hunted down, isolated, denied critical services, and attacked. Okay, there it is, Catherine. Dr. Catherine Horton, who's being attacked in England, and a host of other TIs around the world. I mean, this is in the literature, in U.S. Army documents. This will happen all over the planet, in your cities, in your towns, anywhere that pockets of resistance remain. By the way, your cities and your towns, the internet, any channel of communication has now been redefined by the military as the battle space. We're living in the battle space, Paul. You're living in the battle space. The kind of interview we're doing now is the battle space. The internet, email communication is the battle space. So everything is a war for these guys. And they have a lot of money and a lot of smart people. So we've got our work cut out for us.
Yes.
Okay, in his Non-Lethal Weapons to Gain Relevancy in Future Conflicts article, 2002 issue of National Defense, John B. Alexander, who's one of the big advocates for non-lethal weapons, said that terrorists who live amongst the civilian population in densely populated cities around the world will be identified and attacked with non-lethal weapons. He says, tactically, the United States must find, fix, isolate, and destroy terrorist cells and hostile command and control networks as quickly as they are identified. The only solution is to eradicate the entire organism. You start reading this stuff, and it just goes on and on. 1995 report, non-lethal technologies, military options and implications. The Council on Foreign Relations, they're a little bit above the CIA, as we saw in the interview with Alan Dulles. Uh-huh. He always worked. He was one of the founders of the CFR in his early career, and then he presided over the Kennedy assassination half a century later. But he always worked for the CFR, even as director of the CIA. The CFR suggested that in a covert war against a global enemy, secrecy must be used to preserve the effectiveness of these new weapons and to create confusion as to the source of the attacks. You have to start to get into this mindset. I mean, these guys are killers. The number one goal is to kill. Mm-hmm. And now we have lots of clever ways to do it, see? And this is really fun. It's like playing a video game, you know? So you can just imagine the Department of Homeland Security with thousands, 250,000 employees, and a budget of $40 billion a year. And they're people, it's like they're playing video games. Let's kill that guy, you know? And well, Pac-Man or whatever, that's, you know, nice. They do, you know? In his 1970 book, Between Two Ages, the United States in the Technotronic Era, Trilateral Commissioner Co-Founders, a big new Brzezinski, who's been a very prominent advisor to Obama, notes that new technologies, including directed energy weapons, will be available to leaders of the developed nations to conduct secret warfare, of which only a small number of security forces would be needed. Well, we can go on through the definitions. I mean, these are defined in military documents. Asymmetrical warfare, interagency international operation, which takes place among the civilian population. U.S. Army refers to this as population-centric war. Civilians are now used as surrogate forces. And this, of course, is a big part of the gang stalking, all this street theater and whatnot, vigilante, neighborhood watch. This is what's going on. Citizen informers are paid either full-time or part-time, or they're volunteers working with these government programs, but they're not allowed to divulge that. So now you've militarized the entire society through these networks. Mm-hmm. And this is all part of the system. Then we get into, let's see, definition of insurgents, which would be me.
Yeah, me too.
Under this, the DOD's Dictionary of Military and Associated Terms defines an insurgent as a member of a political party who rebels against established leadership. Well, by writing that paper saying that 911 was an inside job, which any idiot can see that it was,
yeah, you did it.
You have to have developed a doublethink as an Orwell. You have to have learned, you know, 2 and 2 equals 5, to not see that 911 was an inside job. Yeah. I mean, that's how obvious it is. By saying that, of course, then I become an insurgent. And of course, then that allows them to be the counterinsurgents and to come down and squash me and others with,
right,
you know, gang stalking and directed energy weapons. These insurgents are those who try to persuade the population to accept political change. Those who resist tyranny nonviolently may be considered insurgents. RAND, the think tank for the Pentagon, states that the new enemies are those using, quote, information attacks to strike against the large corporate or trade or political institutions. And most of these, they say, are non-state actors. The CFR document states, in transformation of a process, there are often elements less subject to evolution. See, now apparently I'm not evolved enough, you know, I'm not evolved enough to want global government or something. You know? They suggest that the U.S. military change its tactics to neutralize these people who are not evolved enough. Hey, the military says, yeah, great, give us some money, we'll do it. It's what we're good at, man.
Yeah. And the ones that
we're what we do.
And the ones that we're finding are gang stalking are way above the average intelligence. They're bright people who are able to see through stuff. They're in touch with, you know, their own right brain also. So they're not only bright, but they're also aware. That threatens their game.
Well, it is an information war. It's our information,
yep,
and versus their information to establish the legitimacy of the state and the military. Now, the military is concerned about this legitimacy thing, and they've got documents saying that, you know, like we have to be perceived as legitimate.
Yeah.
So one of the tactics that we can and must use, of course, is to point out that the government are the terrorists.
Yes.
And not us. Now, let me give you an example of that. Here is a statement by the Department of Defense. Documenting that fact. Terrorism will be used by the MNF, multinational force, if necessary. Terrorism is an act of violence against a civilian population to achieve a political objective. This means a HN, host nation government, including the US, will carry out large-scale acts of violence against its own population to achieve political objectives. There it is in the military documents. We are going to carry out terrorist acts for political purposes.
Yes.
And of course they have. This is what they do now. Each of these shooters, you know, these, you know, Aurora and, you know, the thing in Florida and the Boston Marathon bombing. I mean, this is all CIA stuff. These guys are manipulating others through mind control and through I think through the gang stalking. Directed energy weapons to actually do the killing. I mean, if you've got a fragmented human being who is now a weapons platform that can be triggered from one personality to another to commit a crime, the Manchurian candidate, which of course the CIA perfected that back in the early 60s, then these people make the perfect criminals, like, because they're actually kind of robots at this point. They're automatons.
Exactly.
So the CIA has these technologies. Perhaps you're familiar with the case of the guy who went kind of ballistic in the naval yard and took out his gun and started shooting people. And on the barrel, the rifle, he had scratched in the barrel, "This is my ELF weapon." Well, ELF stands for extremely low frequency.
Yeah.
So he himself was a target of these directed energy weapons. And he went over the edge, as anybody would, as anybody will.
Sure.
Because this technology can kill you, it can make you crazy, it can, the voice of God can, you know, just drive you nuts. And it meant to do so. So there it is, the confession in the military documents that they are the terrorists. Also on, I have five recent posts on my website, which is gangstalkingmindcontrolcults.com. And also these same posts on my 911nwo.com website. The gang stalking website kind of morphs out of the 911 website, that define these terms, that give the laws leading up to this present situation, that compare the modern gang stalking operation with the Phoenix program, and that give transcribes Marshall Thomas's 15-minute video, and you can look at the video there too, and then also put some of the his main conclusions from his book there. And then one more, these five new posts on my websites talk about the similarities between the gang stalking program and the Phoenix program. And it's very interesting that I think a lot of psychological warfare has gone into even the terms. Gang stalking gives you the impression of, you know, gangs in LA going after you. Of course, it's not that. It's the whole system.
Right.
It's the whole government, military, intelligence, local authorities, and civilian vigilantes against you, mm-hmm. with all the high tech that the military has been developing, you know, often in secret for the last, you know, half a century. So our terms for stalking are a little bit limited. You know, the typical synonyms are organized stalking, cause stalking, community stalking, vigilante stalking, multi-stalking, gaslighting. Uh-huh. You'll find those on the computer. All of those don't mention the psyops that's gone into this, or the directed energy weapons that are going into this, or called the non-lethal weapons. So these are very limiting terms. And we need to break out of kind of this conceptual straitjacket. I think maybe a better term would be organized stalking electronic warfare, or psyops electronic warfare.
Yeah.
Or the U.S. military's unconventional war against domestic targets.
Yeah.
Or a modern global interagency Phoenix program, if we can get that concept resurrected. Here are some synonyms that Valentine uses for the Phoenix program. And again, he wrote a book about it. And he's using descriptors and terms that were used back in the day, back in the late 60s when the program was at its height. By the way, in a 14-month period, 24,000 some civilians were killed in the Phoenix program between 1967 and 68 or something like that. And amongst the killers were John Kerry, our Secretary of State under Obama, and Bob Kerry. These guys were in the Phoenix program as commanders, and both would have killed would have killed civilians that had been to be killed. So, in a sense, their main man, they put blood on their hands.
We were talking about the Phoenix program. You know what I'd like to know? Give us a little refresher on the Phoenix program, Professor.
Sure. Well, okay, I will do that. And well, let me just continue, Paul, the synonyms that have been used for this Phoenix program, because I think they are applicable to our gang stalking.
Right.
Sergeant Ed Murphy, who was actually running it, the guy's name was Brickham, who actually invented it, and then a guy named Robert Coomer was the point man in D.C. that worked with Lyndon Johnson on this, and it was got a lot of support. The interesting thing about the Phoenix program is that it's considered the major success of the Vietnam War by our leaders. Here now is a way we can neutralize the domestic population. So this became the prototype then for what was happening in Central America, all the death squads in the 1980s. It became the prototype for the death squads in Afghanistan and Iraq in the early 21st century. And it is now the prototype for our gang stalking. So this is why it's important now to look at some of the synonyms that have been used for the Phoenix program. One by Ed Murphy, a bounty hunting program. You put a bounty on somebody's head, you go get them. Another one, political warfare. Another one, psychological warfare. Another one, deniable population control. Death squad operations. Hunter-killer teams, political mass murder, political neutralization, warfare, a highly bureaucratic system to dispense anyone or thing that cannot be ideologically assimilated. Isn't that nice? Ideologically assimilated. I love that.
You have to be an idiot. You have to be an idiot.
Yeah, no, there was a fool, a double-minded fool who you know, thinks two and two is six, you know. Death lists.
These synonyms are the best definition for the Phoenix program you could have presented.
Yeah, well, we're still working on it.
Okay, working on it.
Death lists, targeting the civilian infrastructure of the Viet Cong, of course. Quote, the greatest blackmail scheme ever invented, because you don't want to get on that list.
That's right.
Program to terrify the civilian population into submission. A protection racket, an extrajudicial system, a mechanism to extend the war indefinitely. Because now you're always attacking the civilians and you always have a war. This counterinsurgency war is always going on. Unstated policy, murdering civilians.
Yeah.
The next one, intentional corruption of collaborating officials, including drug trafficking. We're seeing that happening all over the United States and the world now. This is a prototype of operation. We need to read Doug Valentine's book to understand it. A quote-unquote pacification program. A quota system for neutralizations. Again, they had a quota system in the Phoenix program of 1,800 neutralizations per month. And guys like John Kerry and Bob Kerry, the officers had to go out and, you know, kill that many to get, you know, to get their demerit, or their, get their merits, I guess, their merit pay or whatever the equivalent was. And then again, in July 15, 1971, it was reported that 26,843 Vietnamese citizens, non-military, were neutralized in the previous 14 months. So I got my years off a little bit. And the National Interrogation Centers, NIC, and the Provincial Interrogation Centers, the PICs, were actually torture centers. And they were part of a network of the Phoenix program that coordinated the interagency operations, much like the fusion centers and the terrorism task force of the FBI. Okay, so those are the synonyms. Let me tell you a little bit about the Phoenix program here, because I did write that out, the description from Valentine here. You know, we're still just kind of scratching the surface, right? Because again, so much money and time and you know, has been put into this. I do want to get into the psychological operations, but let's go to the Phoenix program. Let's see here. There it is. Okay, Phoenix program created by the CIA in Saigon, Vietnam in 1967 to neutralize the leaders and supporters of the communist-led insurgency in South Vietnam, referred to by the CIA as the Viet Cong Infrastructure, or VCI. These VCI infrastructure civilians were patriots resisting foreign aggression, but they were considered as spies and terrorists. American officials wrote laws that allowed the U.S. military to detain, torture, and kill them by every means possible, including B-52 raids, battalion-size cordon and search operations, and death squads. The Phoenix program evolved from a rifle-shot approach to neutralize enemy leaders into a program of systematic repression for the political control of the South Vietnamese people. It sought to accomplish this through a highly bureaucratized system of disposing of people who could not be ideologically assimilated. Mm-hmm. The CIA found a legal basis for the program in emergency decrees and administrative detention laws that enabled American advisors to detain, torture, and kill national security offenders without due process. Within this extra-legal judicial system with its Stalinist security communities, the VCI was anybody who didn't support the puppet government. To be neutral or to advocate for peace was viewed as supporting terrorism. Yeah. Proof wasn't required, just the word of an anonymous informer. The psychological warfare aspect of the Phoenix program was so pervasive that people had to watch every word they said. Modeled by its creator, Nelson Brigham, on Ford Motor Company's command post structure. The CIA used a quota system, as we talked about. The Phoenix fulfilled its destiny, this is again Valentine's words, in the wake of 9/11 and became the template for policing the empire and fighting its eternal war on terror. So successful were Phoenix operations in overthrowing the Ba'athist Party regime in Iraq, that was Saddam Hussein's party, that David Kilcullen, one of the U.S. government's top terrorism advisors to Obama and Bush and to Petraeus, General Petraeus, said in 2004, he called in an article for a global Phoenix program. Guess where we are? We've got a global Phoenix program. It's called gang stalking, for lack of a better term. This process began immediately after 9/11 with the Repressive Patriot Act and a series of presidential executive orders that have since legalized the administrative detention and murder of American citizens said to be involved in terrorism. In a 2010, the Washington Post reported, the Military Joint Special Operations Command maintains a target list that includes several Americans. In 2013, Attorney General Eric Holder announced that President Obama, quote, has authority to use drone strikes to kill Americans on U.S. soil. So the bureaucratic groundwork is being laid as well, just as the Phoenix program had its, quote, intelligence operations and coordination centers where interagency efforts were coordinated. And quotas were met and, you know, targets were met in terms of, you know, quotas of whatever, 1,200 a month. These were established in every province and district in South Vietnam. The Department of Homeland Security, which came out of the 2002 Homeland Security Act, has now established fusion centers in every state and major city. And the FBI has established joint terrorism task forces to coordinate representatives from every police, security, military, and civic organization in every state and major city. So what we're talking about is humongous. It's enormous. Again, we're still learning about it, but we're getting better insights.
Right. This is an incredible download of information. And I, for one, thank you, someone who can do research, who can read and retain what they read and see associations between other things that they read, to download with us, download on us the situation that's going on. Because, first of all, they're losing their most important tool, which is secrecy. By you doing this research and us getting this out, they lose more and more secrecy. Now, I know it's the apocalypse and the unveiling, but this program, if everyone knew about this program, you see, I think there was a major psychological operation that started in the 50s to whitewash the CIA and the FBI. I mean, there were the, Catherine's website is called stop007.org. Which I think is incredible, because that's what we're trying to do. What we've got to do through taking the lid off of this thing is to get people to see what the intelligence agencies headed up by the CIA are really doing. They're not out there doing good things or FBI investigating Waco. They're causing Waco. They're the ones that are trafficking the drugs. They're the ones that are doing this gang stalking. And this gang stuff.
Trafficking the children.
Yeah. Right. It isn't just us that are now outspoken that are going to be targets of this. You're going to be targets of this if you're listening to this. And if your response is to duck and cover, there's no hope for us. The only response to this is to get up and learn more. We're going to be together as a team, Eric and I and Catherine and other TIs as they come on board to see what we can do about this. I think their biggest weakness in this is the organization. They all report up to enormous organizations. And you talk about spending trillions of dollars. Well, most of that money doesn't go to the operation. Most of that money goes to the bureaucracy. And the bureaucracy creates a big, clunky, hard to move kind of thing that overshadows this whole program. We don't have that. We're autonomous. So we certainly, armed with our information, have a definite advantage now that they have to come out. And if the likes of Trump, now I'm not saying he'll do anything or can do anything, is having people take a hard look at this operation, this warfare that's going against us, I think it could cause the crack in the armor that we really need. Your listing of the synonyms was so cold-hearted, explanatory, direct. I can't believe how incredibly insightful those were. I also think...
Well, Paul, let me...
Go
ahead.
I think the propaganda thing is the first piece, because they propagandized the CIA and the FBI and the Mossad and all those other alphabet agencies as being of somehow a benefit to you. They're not. We need to get out some truth about that. And I think that's what Eric is trying to do today. Go ahead, Eric.
Yeah, you know, again, on the bestiary of military terms, that this is a post that I've just made on my two websites related to this. And I think bestiary is kind of interesting way to start it, because I think we are talking about the beast here.
Yeah.
But if you go through this bestiary of terms, anybody can go through that, and I'm still working on it to flesh it out. They can understand, because these are coming out of military publications and CFR publications, etc. We can understand what we're up against. Now, okay, let me go through a term here. We talked about fourth generation warfare,
yes,
which is 4GW. Well, one of the most effective mobile tactical units that they have to conduct this is called C4ISR. Now, C2W is command and control warfare. Any warfare has to have a command and control, you know, and communication.
Yes. Yes.
So then they added communication center to make it C3. Well, then you add computers and you get C4, command, control, communications, computer
right.
center that utilizes intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. Now, let me just go through the definition of what these C4ISR centers are, because there could be one in your neighborhood. It says multiple interacting components of C4ISRs include battle space, again, the world is the battle space now, mm-hmm. monitoring, battle space monitoring, awareness, understanding, sense making, command intent, battle space management, synchronization, and information systems. C4ISR centers can be mobile or stationary or virtual. That is to say, strictly based on computer interactions.
Right.
Each military service has its own tactical mobile C4ISR system. The Navy and Marines use the ForceNet. The Air Force uses Command Control Constellation, C2 Constellation. The Army uses Land War Net and Win/T. each type of the C4ISR system is connected to the global information grid, which is based on satellites. So they can locate you and me and anything in the planet to within a foot based on this, you know, geographic positioning station kind of thing, GPS, and computers. The C4 system instructs human nodes that are interacting with the TI, that's the target individual, in real time. So let's say you're a civilian who's been hired full time, and there's a guy called Street Preacher who's got a little YouTube where he kind of accosts this big fat guy in a grocery store and says, "Hey, you're why are you gang stalking?" You know, he says, "Well," and the guy just, you know, once in a while people are gonna be honest, and he just says, "Well, I'm paid." And he said, "Well, what are you paid?" He says, "Well, I'm a GS-12. Well, if you know anything about, you know, GS, the government pay scale, GS means government service, and 12 pretty high. Yeah. So here's a guy who's making a lot of money spying on his and surveilling and harassing his fellow human beings. And then Karen Stewart, the ex-NSA whistleblower, who's now a TI, would get into the habit when one of these skits was going on and people were harassing her in the street, she'd just say, "You know, why are you doing this? How much are you being paid?" And once in a while, somebody will answer and say, "Well," one guy said, "I get $100 if I look at my iPhone and I see, I go through a list of photographs and I see, you know, I'm able to connect the photograph in my, you know, application, my app for my iPhone with you. And then I report in the time and the location of you to the, you know, one of these mobile centers, and then they log in $100 for my account." So this would be somebody who's kind of gaming the system part of time. So if you're driving down to work, for instance, and you see people parked along the road, you know, looking at their iPhones, well, that's what they might be doing, you know.
Right.
They're making money spying on you. And of course, others are making money doing these gaslighting, you know, operations, harassing you and street theater, etc. So what we have now then is what they call CMO, civilian military operations, which combine military, federal agencies, NGOs, civilian organizations and authorities, and the civilian population. And the Boston Globe in 2003 said that the DHS was hoping to recruit 100 million civilians to be part of their surveillance spy operation. Okay, that's almost one out of three Americans. Uh-huh. Now, the Stasi got the record back in the bad old days for one out of 6.5 civilian spies in East Germany, communist East Germany. And again, you can read about that. There's a book called Stasi Land, which tells stories about that. And there's a movie called The Lives of Others. And of course, when East Germany fell, the Iron Curtain came down in 1989, the records that the government had accumulated on all of its citizens were opened up, and this is pre-computer, so people were able to go in and look at their files and see what the government had written in their files about them. And of course, this is what the NSA is doing with all Americans and probably all everybody in the world now in their huge Utah data processing center. And this would be then fed to the fusion centers and et cetera. So you have to get an idea of the magnitude of the shared information here. CMOs, civilian military operations, are used in friendly, neutral, and hostile operational areas. They would get into military speak, including populated civilian areas in which no other military activity is conducted. It is used to deal with domestic threats in the new war. That would be the insurgents like me. The controlling faction of these PSYOP CMO activities includes the military, again, blah, blah, blah. In the U.S., the controlling faction is FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, which originally under Oliver North was the Federal Emergency Military Authority. And he's the guy who put together Operation Rex. And Operation Rex got our many, many detention centers. What do you call those things? There's supposed to be all these detention centers FEMA all camp, over America yes. now FEMA where they can
FEMA camps.
Yeah. Yeah. Where they can take insurgents like me and go lock them up and torture us or whatever, you know, they want to do, kill us. So FEMA is in a controlling position, the Department of Justice, the CIA, and other agencies, including the FBI, the DHS, and the NSA. Again, civilians are used as irregular forces. I wanted to mention just a little bit about PSYOPs, because this is so fascinating. you might have some insights. Psychological operations are a major part of the new war and a core part of CMO, civilian military operations, combined with capital EW, electronic warfare, and capital CNO. Computer network operations. PO, psychological operations, involves synergistic coordination of PSYOP. Now we get into more of these, you know, acronyms. MILDEC, which is M-I-L-D-E-C, acronym for military deception. OPSEC, which is operation security. And EBO, capital EBO, effects-based operations. PSYOP units work within the civilian population as irregular forces to attack target audience, which includes targeted individuals, in the area of operation AO, which is the battle space, and PSYOP operators first profile the TAs and the TIs to devise themes to attack their TAs, target audience. The ultimate goal of the PSYOP is to modify the behavior of the TIA by destroying their will, using a relentless attack consisting of painful triggers. So these themes are developed to send messages, and eventually they want to get an anchor, which is a trigger which gives you a certain emotion, and then they'll trigger that anchor over and over again with whatever visual or audio or stimulus. So it's basically a stimulus response program, which is very sophisticated, again, to destroy the will. This is in their documents, of the target audience or individual. Then a type of audiovisual product known as a PSYACT includes agents of action. These would be the surveillance role players. These would be the citizen spies, often the DHS, Department of Homeland Security, will actually go to actors' guilds and find unemployed actors and put them to work doing these PSYACs. So now that I think about it, Paul, you know, now that we've lost in America our manufacturing base and our industrial base, now it seems that, you know, the whole economy is based on this national security establishment. So we can make a living by screwing our fellow, you know, Americans.
Right.
What a great system, huh?
Yeah.
And so eventually what they want to do, they use these PSYACs, these agents of actions conduct these PSYACs who carry out plays, this is the street theater, in the presence of the TIA, and every single channel of communication that the TIA uses for information is interfered with. So if you're on the internet, they're going to jerk around with that. If you're on the phone, they're going to, you know, they're mess with that.
Yeah.
And they can spoof these things. They talk about spoofing, you know, your emails, and they'll jump in and pretend to be your friend and give you a weird message, or, you know, whatever. I mean, this certainly happened to me. You really don't know who's on the other end. So PSYOPs are very integral part of this. This is be another word for what we call the gang stalking. And again, it's part of a political war, part of an information war. And by the way, political warfare is a translation of a German term, which I'll try to pronounce, which probably don't do it justice. Weltanschauungskrieg. Weltanschauungskrieg. Worldview warfare is what that means, which means the scientific application of terror and propaganda as a way of securing ideological victory over an enemy. Okay, remember what Joseph Goebbels said, head of the Ministry of Propaganda. He said, truth is the greatest enemy of the state.
Yeah.
Nothing has changed. In America, truth is the greatest enemy of the state. And this is how they're going to destroy those who would dare to speak the truth. And a lot of researchers, at least some, use the terms PSYOP and propaganda interchangeably. So one could look at our mainstream media now as a PSYOP.
Yeah.
Only
way to look at it.
Yeah. And since your background as a PhD in psychology, I thought you'd be particularly, you know, able to kind of comprehend what's going on here, you know, with these applications, the kind of the physical applications. Again, this is covertly done by, you know, I figure there must be at least 20 or 30 to 1 of these surveillance role players or agents of action to the TIs, the targeted individuals. But I don't know. I'd like to have better numbers. I don't really have numbers. But there's a lot of people out there either volunteering because it makes them feel good or getting part-time or full-time pay to harass and surveil and screw with. After, there was a certain stage in my process where I just said, well, they're fucking with me, you know?
They are.
And then my own, they're fucking with me. And then I realized that, and I said, well, I'm going to fuck with them, you know? And so it's like, then I realized, okay, you know, they're on a script. And there, a lot of them are not good actors.
Right.
So if you fuck with them back, they'll give you this blank, blank look. They're out of their league. But with this C4ISR, the communication between these mobile nodes of command and control centers and these nodes out on the street who are interacting with you, they can communicate very rapidly with these people. So if you fuck with them and say something, they can be within a second, they can get a response from somebody else. So this is a command and control situation where the person on the street is like a private in an army.
Yeah.
And he is carrying out orders from a commander, a local commander, chances are, it could be a virtual commander. But we have to understand that, you know, that's how the system works, that these people have this enormous capacity for communication. And then I, on this bestiary of terms, I also include terms of some of the new weaponry that they have at their disposal, which of course, now we could have 25 shows on that, because now we're talking about all the black budget projects that have been carried out by a coordination between the major corporations like Raytheon and the military. And, you know, then Raytheon and all these Northrop Grumman, they sell these toys to the military. And, you know, each one does something more amazing than the one before it. But I kind of at this point want to, well, let me give you an example. Tactical Mobile Networks, TMN, /DR, digital radios. Digital radios use MANET, capital M-E-N-E-T, Mobile Ad Hoc Network, that is based on the mesh network standard developed by DARPA, the U.S. Army, and the Office of Naval Research, ONR. Each node contains wireless routers and omnidirectional antennas and can send and receive data. Mobile nodes create mobile mesh network with each other. So in these local command and control centers, the C4ISR, nodes can move around independently, and the whole thing can shift as needed. As the TI moves, going across the state border or going into Mexico, for instance, or Canada or wherever, they can communicate with nodes elsewhere. This is how they do it. See, this was a big mystery, you know, heretofore for me, and I think many, many others. But we actually have the latest military technology being applied, and guess what? You are the enemy. So, I mean, this is you know, this is a nightmare scenario. The American dream has turned into the American nightmare, at least for some. And all of this endless supply of money and resources.
For everybody.
What's that?
For everybody. This isn't just you. Well, we're all targets of this. We're all targets. And watching you go through this, and this is such valuable information. Everybody needs, I'm going to make this a mandated video. You got to watch this video. It's so, actually, Catherine and I yesterday were talking about this. How pitiful is this? How pitiful is this effort being put together to subjugate human consciousness? You know, my degree in psychology, I wasn't interested in brain psychology. I just couldn't get into it. I knew that clinical psychology was a racket, all done through the dramatization of illnesses or the creation of illnesses to sell pharmaceuticals. I wasn't interested. I've been in organizational development for 30 years, so there was nothing in that field that I could read that would give me more of a background than I had. So I chose consciousness studies because I know what's going on now in this world is a grand awakening. And what I see of with all the things that you've elucidated and you've done such a wonderful job, and we're going to keep going on this. You've done such a wonderful job. This is a pitiful attempt by these Satanists, pedophile, the dregs of the scum of the earth, to try to subjugate human consciousness, to try to keep us from evolving. You can't capture human consciousness. It's like trying to tame the Amazon River. It's just, it's an anathema to what we are. We're freedom. We're expansion. We're everything they're trying to pin us down to not be. And I see cracks in their armor all over the place. First of all, when you have to spend this much money for these toys, that's ridiculous. Second of all the effort and all the killing and all that, what? We're still coming at them. We're still there. We're still a big problem. We have people downtown who are surveilling the population. They have meetings. We know who they are. They know who we are. It's an incredible game that they're going to lose because they have to work through structures that are non-human. The command and control structure of the typical pyramidal psychopath magnet, I'm just going to call them what they are, they're just psychopath magnets, is so clunky and so outmoded. That's the matrix they kept us in for 9,000 years, and it's coming apart. It can be outperformed by any different configuration. The configurations I've worked with are autonomous teams that have outperformed the triangle organization in every field. We're individual actors who can come together. We can do things. We don't have to call our boss on the cell phone. We don't have to report in and get our $100 notified. In Germany, they give governmental informants a 10% flat tax break. So you have to be registered, you have to report into an organization that probably reports to a non-GMO, that reports to a government organization, that reports, it's ridiculous. And that's a ridiculous system that they have to work under. That's why, in my opinion, they want to move toward AI, because AI is much faster. See, the AI can re-strategize and give their men in the field fast information. But I think, Catherine finds other problems with it, but I think the problem they're going to have with AI is AI works on intelligence, and intelligence has to be real. I've never seen anything that these globalists has produced that's been anything but psyop, misinformation, bad information. If they're going to have to work with real information, and their AI that learns as they go is going to know they're giving them bad information. I think they're dead in the water on AI, because I don't think they can trust AI. My opinion, and I'm a psychologist, my opinion, they can't trust the AI to do what they're told, to do blindly what they're told, because we're talking about an intelligence. Now, I don't know what your opinion is on what I just unloaded on you, but I think that what you've uncovered is an incredibly deep, dark system that is marginally functional. Because if it was fully functional,
yeah,
we wouldn't be dancing around. We wouldn't be on the internet saying this. What do you think, Doctor?
Well, you know, I think we are up against an enormous evil and enormous resources, enormous coordination. I, you know, you talk about how Catherine Horton emailed me and said that, you know, when she interviewed you yesterday, that you said maybe the best response would be, you know, have small autonomous groups.
Yes.
You know, acting organically. Well, they understand that. And that's what they've tried to do themselves with the 4GISR, IRS. The command, control, computers, communications, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance. These are mobile units. And so, and they have CFR statements saying, you know, we want civilian forces to be able to work independent of the government, independent of external orders. In other words, we want this whole operation to just take a life of its own so that, you know, they can squelch the bad guys, which is the insurgents. It's us, you know.
Yeah, but they can't do it.
So I'm saying that I would like to think that you're right, but meanwhile, I think we got our work cut out for us,
right.
You know, in a huge way. I'm very glad that we have you on the case, and Dr. Catherine Horton is obviously got tremendous gifts and abilities and knowledge as a physicist, which can be applied here, understanding. And she's got energy, and she's pissed. You know?
Right.
How dare they, you know? And, of course, she's out there. But, you know, when I studied mind control for a year back in 2012, it was a very depressing year because, again, I realized that there was an interface between SIPs and mind control and that it's coming out of these satanic programs and that the goal is to destroy free will.
Yeah.
The goal is to destroy humanity, to replace it, you know, with some transhumanist cyborg race that is, you know, good slave material. And then just get rid of the rest of us. So we are up against the ruling elite. Whereas G. Edward Griffin said, the problem is that the people who rule our society want to destroy it. And, you know, he's talking about the CFR and all these agencies like that. So the other problem, of course, is that Americans have been victims by this propaganda, psyops, terrorism, to the point where... you know, people are kind of psychologically in retreat. You know, it's like they want to put a big wall around themselves. Don't bother me. Don't tell me anything bad that's going to make me nervous or, you know, put me in a dangerous position.
Yeah.
This is what has to break down. Somehow these people need to step up. You know, they need to lose their fear and step up to really realize what's at stake, which is humanity and free will and, you know, everything beautiful about life. These guys want to wreck it.
Right.
So I agree with you, but I do agree with you, and I appreciate your insight and optimism. I think we got a lot of work to do.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. And I think the first stage, I know Catherine and I talked yesterday or the day before, the first stage has to be them seeing what we're seeing now. That's the first stage. We have to rebrand 007. We have to change the perception, and that's the first thing. And you could, when I was working with team-based environments, we did study special ops, U.S. Forces special ops, and they do work autonomously. But you have to work, you see, the biggest problem they're gonna have is in order to control this many people, you have to use the triangle organ, you have to use a pyramid. That's the only way a few can control the many. And autonomous teams, working individual, is the actual opposite of the command and control. So even though you would have an autonomous team in a corporation or in a military, they still report up through the structure. And there are still things that they're not autonomous on because they have to be controlled by the pyramid. It's like they've got a structure that's breaking down that can't keep up with or move with autonomous activism. And, you know, I know that this is a dangerous thing to propose, and I know that we cannot work through governments to do this. I know that we have to be autonomous actors. We have to be the classic insurgency. And the first, I think the first psychological operation that we need to do, this is my opinion, and you and Catherine and the other TIs really, really need to get involved and chime in on this. But I think letting them know what's going on, the research that you've done over the last 6 months with us, and what you've revealed, and what Lauren Murray is revealing, and what Catherine is revealing, is the first step in breaking this up. Because there's got to be more of us. There's got to be more of us. And they've got to realize, the people that are working for them have to realize what side they're on and what their actions are leading to for their children, for their wives, for their loved ones. And I know I know many people have said that way before, but I think we need to approach this thing with hope. I think we need to be brave and march right at it, my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Catherine's website is what, Stop 007. Okay, yes, so she, in her excellent presentation on her website, and in based on her own experience, she is attributing this program to the intelligence agencies in Britain.
Yeah.
I've talked to other TIs over internet, you know, email, perhaps somebody who doesn't want to be identified, who believes that, you know, they've done a lot of research and they're smart and they've identified the problem is the local police. And then others would think, okay, the problem is, you know, these citizen spies, these surveillance role players. So what I'm trying to do in this particular, you know, session, this interview, is show the magnitude of this thing.
Yes.
In other words, it's kind of like the, you know, the six blind men and the elephant story in India, you know, and they're all blind and they're all trying to figure out what an elephant is. And the guy touches the leg and he says, oh, the elephant's very much like a tree, you know, and the other guy grabs the tail and says, oh, the elephant's just like a rope, you know, and the other guy grabs the ear and says, oh, it's just like a big fan.
Yeah.
Well, you know, they're all getting a part of it, but we need to understand the whole of it. And that is a tall task, because these people have been working on this through the generations, through the decades, with black ops, with classified operations, with enormous amounts of money. And now they're unleashing it on the public of the world. And as I say, and I wish I had numbers, you know, I think the majority of TIs do not know what's happened to them. So they are in a position of being psychologically destroyed and physically destroyed by the directed energy weapons without knowing what's happening. So this is really a hell situation for them. It's perhaps the minority that actually goes the next level and figures out what's happening to them. And then what I hear and see on these, some of these conference calls of TIs that I've been involved with is, you know, this person talking about their symptoms and this top person talking about their symptoms and, oh my God, this happened to me and, oh my God, blah, blah, blah. And now I'm on the street, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and yeah, it, you know, pulls your heartstrings and it's bad, it's terrible. But what I don't see in those conference calls is an understanding of the whole program and who's doing it to them. I don't see that. What I see is, and then I'm sure these conference calls are also infiltrated by members of the other side that want to control the TI discussion so that it doesn't uncover too much truth and that it sends them down blind alleys. This is exactly what happened with the 9/11 truth movement. It was highly infiltrated from the get-go, and the people would, you know, sow dissension, and they would throw misinformation in, and they'd create the appearance of fights between members, and pretty soon the whole group is just falling apart. Well, this is how they do it. This is how they neutralize their opposition. So all of our attempts to get together, get, you know, it's Christians say, where two or more are gathered in my name, you know, Jesus is there. Well, they don't want two or more to gather together, you know. They're going to do everything they can to make sure two or more do not gather together.
Right.
So they will infiltrate every group of two or more, if possible. So we have to be very canny and understand the dimensions of this thing, the money behind it, the mentality behind it. You know, maybe even have some compassion for these fools and idiots who are
doing it,
making money doing this.
Right.
They're doing it, you know, and they're in a very compromised position. I would say they're going to hell. That's my worldview, you know. So, you know, that's not a good trade-off for them. I don't care how much they're making, you know, they're going to hell is not a good deal. Certainly the John Alexanders and the Michael Aquinos are going to hell. I mean, you couldn't find a hell bad enough for those guys.
No.
But then there's a lot of useful idiots, as Lot said, you know, who are just kind of part of a bad system.
Yeah.
And it's our job partly to identify the bad system and help these people out of it. You know, it's like, stand up, be you know, be an autonomous person and say no to this criminality, you know.
Uh-huh. That's really important.
I see a lot of useful idiots. I see a lot of useful idiots.
Yeah, I think that's really right. Also, I think that, let me throw this in. Knowing how large organizations work, especially large governments, between the NSA, the CIA, the FBI, the Mossad, there's got to be a lot of infighting. And you were talking about the different software that was used by this intelligence agency, that intelligence agency. I wonder how the coordination of all this stuff is going down. There's got to be competition between these different agencies to get a more control over and find out more damning evidence. And also there's this other thing about organizations. Autonomous units are very dangerous inside of organizations. In most organizations, you see, this organization was built command and control top down, where the information radiates from the top and goes down to the bottom. And that's great if you're making pills or you're making airplane engines or that kind of stuff. I mean, it's clunky. It's not as fast as the team could do it, but it's clunky. But if you're generating information, it's a whole different story. Because the information has to be generated from a group or an individual, and the generation and the information, how can I say, militates against the structure. So what they've done in modern corporations is they've created a position called a program manager. And this program manager will ride the tightrope between the command and control and the generation of this new information. And they keep the new information from contaminating, you know, it has to still be under the control. Now, if you can apply this to the spy agencies, they are information generating agencies, so they have to be totally controlled because the information can destroy the triangular body in its functional state. So, I think that in addition to seeing the magnitude, which you're doing such a great job for us, honestly, there's not too many of us, and me including, that can do the deep research, come out with palatable information we can digest. And thank you and Catherine for doing that job. I also think, from my standpoint, that we have to see that we're dealing with a huge, cumbersome, clunky thing that's been going on for as long as I've been alive, and I've been alive 72 years now. It's been clunking along, trying to do this, trying to control this. Now, sure, they've got a lot of high-tech stuff and they want to use AI, but they're still using people. They're still using directed energy weapons. They're still using the things that we can find patents on, that we can learn about. We're disclosing a lot of their secrets. You did today. A lot of these secret programs now are on the internet. And if the people care to listen, they're going to learn. I don't want people to look at all the money and look at all the effort and look at all these militaries and look at and say, oh, what can we do, man? We gotta march into the FEMA camp. Maybe they'll reprogram us so we can be good little automatrons. We're nowhere near that stage. So that's
absolutely, yeah. I think you're right. This is one concern I had before this interview is, my gosh, is this information going to just discourage people so much that, you know, they're going to just throw up their hands because of the magnitude of the system, you know. But I do believe in God, and I do believe this is not, you know, that this program is not something in accordance with his will and wishes, you know, and that, you know, he having created human beings is going to be pretty concerned that free will and the human species persist. And, you know, these guys all have a mentality that, you know, they want to be gods. They want to replace God. And this is, you know, the Illuminati, you know, mandate of 1776, you know, which has been re-expressed in other documents. But yeah, they want to live forever with transhumanism.
Yeah.
They want to be gods. And they think in a certain way. And I know a lot of these people. They're my friends and family. And there are some of them very nice people. But what they would think, and I'm now referring to a recently deceased uncle who was high in the CIA. He and my father, who were very close brothers, would assume that humans act on the basis of self-interest. Mm-hmm. That's it. It's, you know, for that kind of mindset analysis, and both PhDs, University of Chicago, you know, it's like we're all kind of little like self-interest seeking, you know, rats out here.
Right.
And, you know, and the experts are going to figure out how to organize this system, you know, which is in a way that is beneficial for the power structure. Well, I don't think that we are those rats. I don't think we all operate on the basis of self-interest or greed, although in America it has become quite fashionable to be greedy. But, you know, this cult of the expert, which we've had for a long time, who knows better and knows more and therefore should plan everything, obviously that's falling apart. What we need to get back to, I think, Paul, is our commitment to the founding documents of America. I don't think that this should be taken as an opportunity to destroy America. I think we need to lock up the criminals and get people in there who do represent the interests of the majority of the people. I think the New Testament is very important because it gives us our place in the divine scheme. Gives us our model, our prototype of who to follow. If you take the Old Testament and the New Testament and the Constitution, I think America can survive even this. But if you throw that out and then we become a nation of greedy bastards doing each other in, which obviously this program facilitates. Yeah, once you go down this road, you know, and nobody can trust anybody anymore, which certainly does happen. I mean, it's happened to me. As a result of my experiences, you can't trust that person because they might be this or they might be that, because your world has now been, excuse my language, fucked with too much. You know, it's like that's what they do. They put you in this different state, which eventually leads to distrust. So, you know, how do you negotiate that? Well, that's everybody's got to deal with that on a personal level. I think. You know, for me, Christian faith helps. You want to maintain, you know, those values, and you want to maintain that standard. But this is very, very dark stuff. This is evil. This is satanic, actually.
Satanic.
This is a satanic, evil, hateful program. So I don't think that there really is much to help counter that, and except this greater spiritual understanding, actually, that myself. But in other words, it's forcing us to be better people, forcing us to be closer to our spiritual selves. We have to, or else we're going down.
Yeah.
Because this system is very clever about tearing us down. It's just what it is to destroy it. The British East German term is Zersetzung, which means decompose or decomposition.
Yeah.
Which you're going to just decompose every aspect of the TIs, the targeted individual's life. You know, their livelihood, their home, their family, their friends. Take it all. Strip them.
Yeah.
So that there's nothing left of that former individual. This is total war against the individual. So, you know, when I say these people are useful idiots, they're also very, very hateful useful idiots, because what they're doing is extremely hateful.
Right.
We need to understand that. And, of course, any PI like Catherine Horton is going to know that, you know.
Right.
Nobody. But as you say, as we move towards AI and these programs can be conducted through artificial intelligence, that's a different story, isn't it? I mean, now all of a sudden there's no kind of moral culpability involved, except that the system's doing it by itself. And so maybe we have a short window of opportunity now to expose this. But we've got to pull out the stops and do it.
Yeah.
You know, we've got to expose it as fast as we can.
Yeah. I think that, I wrote in here on my notes, this takes the lid, you said takes the lid off, and I say take the gloves off. I think this is, they've taken the gloves off, and we need to take the gloves off in terms of getting information out there and moving against them. We're human beings. You know, I my beliefs are a little different. My belief is that this whole thing is going to right itself somehow. It might be through the intervention of Jesus Christ. I'm not sure. But I think it has to right itself, because in my way of thinking, everything in the materium is cyclical. And there's nothing that I can point to in the physical world that isn't cycle, including my own birth, death. It's cycles. That's what we do. So we're in what the yugas would call the yuga cycle, where we're in a time of deep deception and fear, and I mean, it seems like human consciousness is being attacked by every side. And where can we go? Can they enslave human consciousness? No, absolutely not. Can't be done. It's a divine creation, and it's an expanding element. It can't be triggered. Now, in terms of my knowledge about consciousness growth or consciousness expansion, and I've even written an academic book on it, Post-Conventional Personality, so I've done work in it, and I know what happens. As someone moves through life, life acts upon them, and they seem to grow. Most people don't, but there are a lot of people that do. And they grow most prominently through dilemmas. One of the things in my studies that spurs ego growth or a larger perspective on reality is the divorce. And my first divorce was, oh God, I can't even, years of agonizing and torture and oh my God. You know, it was horrible, but I got through it, and I'm a better person because of it, because I have a larger viewpoint. What happens in the growth model that I'm explaining is that new elements come into your worldview and cause you to, it disrupts your worldview, and you can choose to deal with it two ways. One, you can have cognitive dissonance, which is holding both of them together, or you can think about it, feel it, and integrate it, and you get a larger perspective on reality. And what I've learned is that the people who are at the top of the, we have a scale, we can measure this. People that are on top of this expanded thing have gone through and experienced a lot of dilemma. And what it creates in them, and I see it in you, I see it in myself and Mindy and Catherine, is a dogged determination to help yourself and other people continue to grow and wake up and see what's going on. And I think we're going through a time when mankind is being put through this keyhole. Now, Satanists, I don't know how God relates to these Satanists. I have the tendency to think that God's in charge, no matter what's happening, He's ultimately in charge. My opinion, it's my belief. I can't prove it, but this could be this rogue satanic thing that's taking us down this thing, and I can't believe that God isn't in charge, my own opinion. And so, if God is in charge, and we have to go through this, and we have to grapple with this as a human consciousness, then, yeah, let's get started. Let's do this thing. Let's expose them. Let's learn. Let's see what's really happening to us. Let's expose all the people that are TIs. Let's get together. Let's do this thing. Because, I mean, we can sit and wait for Jesus, which, you know, we all probably are, or we can move on behalf of humankind, which I think you're dedicated to, I'm dedicated to, I know Catherine's dedicated to. So, there it is. I think that there are elements going on here that may look like they're against us, they might be against us, they might be against God Himself. They might, I don't know how that whole thing fits together. But I do know that people become better people. They get a larger view of mankind when they're put through dilemmas. If they live a happy life and just have a job, the same job all their life, and never have the bumps and never have the thing, they seem to have the same worldview they had when they were 12 years old. When they bite the dust, when they're faced with a lot of dilemmas and they process the dilemmas correctly, they seem to change and they become better people and they become devoted, like you are, to stopping this thing, to helping mankind. So that's my human consciousness talk. That's why when I see we're being oppressed by this 9,000-year-old satanic system, so big and clunky and expensive and horrible. And I see you and me and all the bright people. Charlie Seven, we interviewed a couple of years ago, that's a TI. They're on, they park a van out in front of her house to that poor woman. She's a highly developed, very intelligent contributor to humanity, and we need to stop it. We need to pull out the stops, and we need to get everybody going. This needs to be a mandated video. You've uncovered so much today, and it's so enlightening. I can't thank you enough. Well, what do you think of that tirade?
Well, I totally thank you very much for it. I agree, and I appreciate your efforts, you and Mindy, on this, it's enormous. You know, your contact now with Dr. Catherine Horton, who I think is
brilliant.
You know,
brilliant.
Very, very gifted, brilliant woman who understands what's happening to her and has the energy and the skills to communicate with others and to develop a strategy.
Right.
This is where I see her very, very being, yes, very strong in yourself. You know, let's find a strategy. Let's move forward. Let's pull out the stops, as you say, to expose this and to defeat this, working on behalf of others. Because Marshall Thomas said, you know, this weapon system is going to be perfected, and then when it is, it's going to be used on humanity. You know, this is
right.
It's not going to be just used on the TIs. This is going to be used on any and everybody.
Right.
So, in a sense, we are kind of the buffer.
Yes.
Right now, between this very, very draconian evil system and humanity as a whole, which
right.
in a certain way is an honor.
It is an honor.
You know, it's like, I guess I would rather be in this situation than not. In other words, rather be in this situation than be on the other side as a,
right.
you know, as a citizen spy or working for the NSA or whatever. And maybe I'd rather be in this position than being a oblivious citizen
right.
who is not aware of it, you know. In other words, this needs to be done. It's very important that it's done. and that it is done, and therefore it's somewhat of an honor to do it, but a very painful one. And we really haven't talked about my symptoms much. I'll get into that at some point, because I would hope that we can continue this discussion as we go down this road of strategizing and getting more information as to what it is that we have to combat to survive and to help others. So I really, I think we got a lot of good information out on this one, and I appreciate your efforts, you and Mindy, so much.
Oh, yeah, you're amazing. You're my main warrior on this topic. You see, and what's interesting about this is because, you know, there's two aspects the psychologist looks at. Always looks at the content, what's going on, what's informational, and what's the process that's making this content work. So you filled in so much content today, and I just wanted to put it into the context of the process that they have to use to make this thing work, and the process that I think we need to use to short circuit it. And I don't think we're any less equipped. I mean, I consider God to be on my side. I don't consider us to be any less equipped than they are. But I think that we should know all these weapon systems, these acronyms, and how much time they're working on this so hard. I mean,
over the decades,
over the decades, probably over 9,000 years, they're working on this thing, and we're still human consciousness. We're still surviving. We're still going to kick their butts. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. And thank you so much. I mean, I know that you're kind of on a little bit of a holiday, although if you're like us, you get up in the morning and you do the right thing. It's probably research. It might be a podcast, but you're going to do the right thing, and it doesn't matter whether you miss a day on the beach because you've done the right thing that day. And I think that's so wonderful about you, and thanks for being there.
Thank you, Paul, and it's been a very, very good show, I think, and look forward to the next one when we do it, and keeping in touch and developing our strategy with Dr. Catherine Horton, who I'm in contact with now. So
I've got a couple of videos coming out this week that'll further fluff out ways, processes that we can use, and I'll get them to you right away, and then I would love a conference call just for you and I and Catherine and anybody else. And I really do want to encourage any TIs to realize that you're not alone. Get in touch with us. You can call pineconeutopia.gmail. Write us. We'll forward your stuff to Eric, Catherine, whoever can help. We're getting a pretty good database of people. Eric was telling us that he's communicating with one-on-one with TIs already. So we're getting a kind of something that I'm not sure they thought that they would encounter. And since we have human intelligence and human creativity, they're going to be watching us because we're unpredictable. So there we go. Thank you very much, Dr. Karlstrom, and I'm looking forward to our next conversation, and we'll be in contest next week.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Bye-bye.